Hello everybody and welcome to Harper James and our latest webinar. Today I'm joined by Sean Walsh, one of my employment law colleagues in my employment team, and my name is Simon Gilmore. I'm an employment partner in the team. We're going to be talking to you about the hot topic of employment status and what your business needs to know. The webinar itself should last approximately 45 minutes. We are very welcoming of any comments that you've got to make or any questions throughout the webinar. So please use the instant messenger facility for doing so. Charlotte Smith is our organizer today, and she will be monitoring the IM facility. So what are we covering today? Firstly, I will start by way of an introduction of the topic. I'll then look at why does employment status matter. In doing so, we'll consider definitions of employee, worker, and independent contractor. I'll then look at tax status in terms of employment context and how the tax man is looking at employment status, and in particular IR35 issues that can arise. I'll then hand over to Sean, who's going to look at some recent case law, in particular the Supreme Court's recent judgment in the Pimlico Plumbers case, and also recently publicised cases involving Uber drivers and delivery workers. Sean will also talk about the gig economy, as it's so called, and the different types of workers that we are experiencing these days, including casual workers and agency workers. He'll then wrap up looking at some practical measures for you to take away in the context of dealing with employment status. On to the next slide then, looking at the introduction. I know that everyone hates lawyers saying it's a grey area of law, but this genuinely is, I'm afraid. In the good old days, and I'm probably showing my age here a little bit, but we used to have the rather black and white situation of employees and employers, or master and servants, as they used to be called. And if you weren't an employee, you were an independent contractor. Not anymore, I'm afraid. And now we have this category called worker. And within that, we have different types of worker. There is overlap between the categories to cause even more confusion. For example, looking at the statutory definitions of employees and workers, and if someone who's working is not an employer worker, then they are usually a self-employed independent contractor. To make matters worse, there is no clear set of defining criteria on status. The definitions in the legislation are not particularly helpful. And so there's been a whole raft of case law trying to help us determine what is an employee, a worker, etc. And I'll be looking at that shortly. As I said, there are now many different new ways of working in the so-called gig economy, where there is much more flexibility for employees to do the work in different ways, different times, in different places. And the advancement that we have seen in technology has also caused significant changes in how we work. Because of the importance of how we work and employment status, there have been a series of consultations, inquiries, and reviews into employment status, most notably the Taylor review, which took place last year and led to the government's response back in March of this year. Because of the uncertainties around some of the areas and this being a grey area of what is an important area of law, it is likely that we will see some significant changes over the next few years. For example, perhaps clarity around definitions of who is an employee and a worker, and what rights they do have. So on to the next slide then, looking at why does employment status matter? firstly, looking at it from the employees' perspective, employees do have certain obligations and do have certain rights implied into their employment contract. These rights are implied by reason of either case law and or legislation. So they have a right to receive certain levels of notice, either a statutory minimum notice or in some cases a reasonable notice. They have certain rights and obligations under health and safety legislation. And there is implied in every employment contract a mutual duty of trust and confidence. So both employer and employee owe that duty to each other. Perhaps more importantly, from an employee perspective, they have additional protections which other categories of worker do not have. Firstly, they have a right not to be unfairly dismissed. They also have a right to statutory redundancy pay in a redundancy situation. And where applicable, they are covered under the protections set out in TUPE. They're also covered by the ACAS Code of Disciplinary and Grievance, which doesn't apply to workers. In addition, they have family-friendly rights, for example, relating to maternity, paternity, parental leave, etc. They have the right to request flexible working. They have a right to written particulars of employment, and they have a right not to be subject to unlawful deductions. In contrast, if we look over the page onto the next slide, these are rights that employees and workers have. So all those rights that we've just been looking at, if you're a worker, you do not have those rights or those protections. So employees and workers have the right. Sorry, go back a slide, please. Employees and workers have the right to national minimum wage under the National Minimum Wage Act, and they also have the right to paid annual leave and rest breaks and a maximum working week under the working time regulations. Employees and workers also have the right not to be discriminated against in accordance with the Equality Act. So in addition to the importance of status for obligations and rights and protections, status in terms of whether you're an employee or worker or a contractor is very important in terms of how you are treated from a tax treatment perspective and liability to HMRC. Now, one thing that these slides doesn't cover is contractors' rights and obligations, because actually there are no contractors' rights and obligations in law other than anything that has been agreed between the parties. So if you are a contractor, you don't have any rights not to be unfairly dismissed or not to be discriminated against, etc. So very much unprotected, but a lot of contractors are quite happy with the advantages that brings, including in relation to tax, and we'll look at that shortly. So over onto the next slide, we look at the issue of determining employee status, so determining whether you're an employee, a worker or a contractor. Firstly, looking at it from an employee perspective, as I say, there are some statutory definitions, but unfortunately these are not very helpful. Under section 230 of the Employment Rights Act 1996, an employee is an individual working under a contract of employment, where that contract is a contract of service or apprenticeship, which is expressed or implied. So that's the only guidance we get under the legislation. Now, bear in mind this legislation is over 20 years old. It hasn't moved with the times and therefore does need to be changed. As a result, we are relying very much on case law to determine what is an employee, what is a worker, etc. And as I say, Sean will be looking at some recent cases on that shortly. I'm going to be looking at the result of some of those cases in looking at the tests for determining employee and worker status, etc. So questions, do we have to record that there is an employment contract? The answer is no. If anything is in documentation saying that there is an employment relationship, then that may be helpful. But in reality, what happens in practice is what counts, and a court or tribunal will look beyond the employment contract or any other documentation to see what happens in practice. Likewise, the intention of the parties, whilst perhaps relevant, doesn't go beyond what is happening in reality. So again, the courts and tribunals will look to see what happens in practice. The employment contract can be either in writing or oral, and employment status can in fact change. So for example, if you had a handyman who was working for your little business involving a couple of other workers one day, and then 10 years down the line, you're a massive business and that handyman is now not working on an as and when basis as a contractor, he is now working for you every day. His status from a contractor will almost certainly have changed to one of either employee or worker. So if he's going to be a worker, firstly, you've got to show the irreducible minimum. So the basic minimum standard that is required to become an employee. And that means three factors. Firstly, there must be personal service. So the individual must work and provide his services or her services direct for the employer. There's no way you can substitute or delegate that. Likewise, the employer would be expected to have a level of control over the employee in terms of what they do, how they do it, when they do it, etc. Obviously, in a senior employee or a professional situation, that level of control would be reduced, but there would still be a level of control there. Another factor not on the slide is the issue of mutuality of obligation, whereby the employer is obliged to provide work and pay the employee for any work done, and the employee is obliged to do that work. If there is no mutuality of obligation, then quite often there's no employment relationship. There are also other factors which are taken into account, none of which are necessarily determinative, but all of which can be relevant, including whether the individual employee is free to work for others or not. Usually in an employment situation, an employee would only work for a business. The nature and length of engagement is also relevant, and usually you'd expect an employee to be working on an ongoing basis unless there is a fixed term contract. And also their work would not be limited to a specific task or project. You'd also expect to see employees receiving regular pay, usually at a regular amount. And they'd also normally receive employee type benefits such as bonus, healthcare, pension, etc. Similarly, you'd also expect employees normally to be integrated within the business. For example, they look and feel a part of that business in terms of perhaps wearing uniform, perhaps being on the phone list, having their own work email address, etc. You expect employees to be provided with the facilities and equipment they need to do their work, for example, a laptop or work tools. And finally, you'd expect employees to be not responsible for payment of their own tax and national insurance, and normally employers would pay for that through PAYE. So if the irreducible minimum is there, personal service control and mutuality obligation, and a number of those other factors, then that looks and feels like an employment relationship. But onto the next slide then, look at the issue of determining worker status. We have further definition in section 230, subsection 3 of the Employment Rights Act. Again, this isn't helpful. And here we have the situation where individuals who are workers carrying out work or personal service could be considered to be workers, but no further definition is included. Again, we are looking to case law for some guidance here. It is often referred to that workers have, if you like, a lower pass mark than that required for employees. So a number of the factors that you'd see for workers for employee status exist, but not to the same level or degree. So certain requirements are necessary for there to be a worker situation. There needs to be a contract, which can be oral, implied, or in writing. It needs to be for personal service, though in this situation, a worker may have some limited ability to provide substitute or delegate, usually where they can't do the work, for example, they're ill. But in a situation where the worker is providing services to a client or customer, that would not necessarily create a worker situation. Does there have to be mutuality of obligation? Not necessarily. So overall, the main difference, it is a matter of degree between worker and employee, but the main difference is around the level of linkage between the individual and the business they're working for, the amount of dependence there is, the amount of responsibility that that individual has to that business. So finally, we look at how do we look at self-employed independent contractors onto the next slide. And basically, working is not within the definition of employee or worker, according to those tests we've looked at, is going to be considered a self-employed independent contractor. And usually what you see there is an unlimited right to appoint a substitute or delegate the provision of the services. Usually you see an ability to work outside of that particular business or client that they're providing services for, perhaps for a number of other different clients or businesses, perhaps with some limitations where there's going to be a conflict. And usually you will see a high degree of control by the contractor over how the services are provided, when, where, etc. Looking at the contract can help, but I've seen many consultancy agreements which are clearly, in fact, employment contracts. So again, a court or tribunal would look behind any documentation and see what happens in practice. A final point, personal service companies. Now, this is something that came in to fashion a lot in the 1990s, where a lot of individuals were looking to reduce their tax liability and provide services of themselves as individuals through a personal service company, where they effectively owned and ran that company, and they provide their services to the end user or client. They did so for two reasons. Firstly, the client or end user perhaps didn't want that person on the payroll and wanted to reduce the risk of any subsequent employment claims. But more importantly, the individuals who set up the personal service companies were looking to improve their tax position. And this is what gave rise to IR 35, which we look at on the next slide. So, as I say, HMRC became wise to the personal service company ruse, and obviously keen to attract and get back more, as much revenue as they could, brought in IR 35 in 2000. They felt that this was a way of tax avoidance and needed to be stopped. It has proved over the last 18 years to be a difficult and contentious area of law, and there have been a significant amount of cases brought as a result of it. Generally speaking, these are brought in the tax tribunals. The key question is as to whether IR 35 arises here, is whether, were it not for the personal service company, the individual working for the client, if they're working direct, would they be considered to be an employee? So you've got to look then at a test for employment status, which we'll look at shortly. The HMRC brought in a check employment status online tool back in 2017 to help individuals work out whether or not they were covered by IR 35 and what their employment status was. Hopefully, obviously, to try and generate more revenue for the inland revenue and avoid people missing out on any tax liabilities. If IR 35 does apply, So if the employee, the individual would be considered an employee were it not for the personal service company, then what happens is any payments that are paid to the personal service company for that individual's services are subject to PAYE. So the personal service company has to deduct income tax and national insurance on any such payments. So does this have an effect on employment status? Basically, no, because employment tribunals and tribunals dealing with tax are two different jurisdictions. However, the tests used in both tax and employment tribunals are largely the same, which we'll look at shortly. So onto the next slide. Here we have some of the guidance given by HMRC on employment status. And I'll go through this pretty quickly because most of this is a repetition of what we've just seen, but it does give an indication of how HMRC are looking at this issue of employment status for tax purposes. They are looking firstly for two key elements. Firstly, they're looking for personal service, the obligation to provide service personally, and also the mutuality of obligation, which we've just discussed. If there is a right of substitution and engagement of helpers, then that will point towards there being a contractor situation or a worker situation as opposed to an employee situation, and IR 35 wouldn't apply. However, without a right of substitution, it doesn't necessarily mean that IR 35 doesn't apply. If the client or the engager rejects the application for a request to substitute, again, that may help show that IR 35 does apply, and this is an employee situation. Similarly, if the worker provides their own equipment, then that looks more like a contractor. Onto the next slide, where there is financial risk on the individual or personal service company to cover a training or rectifying any mistakes or picking up liability for any mistakes, then that's again more likely to be a contractor. But if there's no financial risk, then again more likely to be an employee. In terms of integration, if they are seen as part and parcel of the organization, for example, they manage others, then again that looks more like an employee and is considered a strong factor towards an employment situation. Similarly, if there are employee type benefits being provided, such as paid leave over and above working time regulations, paid leave and pension, etc., then again that looks more like an employment situation, and that will be a relevant factor to bear in mind. And on the final slide on tax status, next slide, if there is a terminate on notice, again that looks more like an employment relationship, and therefore that will go towards making this an IR 35 situation. If there are personal factors here, such as you have a skilled worker who works for a number of clients throughout the year and has a business-like approach to obtaining engagement, then HMRC and their guidance say that that would show that that is more of a work contractor situation, so not an employee situation. The intention of the parties can be relevant, but only where the pointers, the factors looking towards worker or contractor or employee status are balanced. So that can only, the intention can only be determinative where it's pretty even as to which factors apply. So hopefully that's a good idea as to why we have employment status, looking at issues around tax and how we determine employment status. I'm now going to hand over to Sean, who's going to take you through some recent case law. Thank you.
That's lovely. Thanks very much, Simon. If we can go to the next slide. What I'm now going to do is I'm going to look at some recent cases which highlight the difficulties associated with this area of law, but do nevertheless provide us with some of the factors the courts take into consideration and the importance of those factors. The first case is Pimlico Plumbers Limited and Mullins v. Smith. Pimlico Plumbers engaged Mr. Smith as a plumber for approximately 5.5 years and then terminated the engagement approximately 4 months after Mr. Smith suffered a heart attack. In August 2011, so yeah, this case has been going on for some time, Mr. Smith issued proceedings in the Employment Tribunal for unfair dismissal, wrongful dismissal, entitlement to sick pay, holiday pay, unlawful deduction of wages, and disability discrimination. Some of those claims would require Mr. Smith to either be an employee and or worker. So as a preliminary issue, the Employment Tribunal had to decide if Mr. Smith was indeed an employee, a worker, or an independent contractor. The tribunal decided Mr. Smith was a worker, and Pimlico Plumbers appealed to the Employment Appeal Tribunal and the Court of Appeal, but lost that appeal, and eventually appealed to the Supreme Court, where it was unanimously held by five Supreme Court judges that Mr. Smith was a worker, and therefore they dismissed Pimlico's appeal. The main consideration for the Supreme Court were the following issues. The first was personal service, which Simon has already touched on. And Mr. Smith's contracts with Pimlico Plumbers gave him no express right to appoint a substitute to do his work. However, there was a finding by the tribunal that Mr. Smith could swap work with another Pimlico Plumber. With this somewhat limited right of substitution, the court framed the question to be answered as, was Mr. Smith's right to substitute another Pimlico operative inconsistent with an obligation of personal performance? In order to answer this question, the court was assisted by previous case law as to whether the dominant feature of the contract remained personal performance by Mr. Smith. The court held that the terms of the contract with Mr. Smith were clearly drafted to performance by Mr. Smith personally. So wording, for example, with regards in the terms in the contract referring to your skills and your appearance must be clean and smart and your ID card must be worn and you will be competent to perform the work, clearly showed in the contract that these were requirements addressed to Mr. Smith personally. Pimlico Plumbers' contention that these requirements were capable of applying to anyone who substituted for Mr. Smith, the court held would stretch their natural meaning beyond breaking point. The court also held that the limitation of Mr. Smith's right of substitution was significant, as the substitute had to come from the ranks of Pimlico operatives, who themselves were also bound by an identical suite of heavy obligations. Pimlico Plumbers then argued it was a client or customer of Mr. Smith, and this indicated that he was therefore on business on his own. To supplement this argument, Mr. Smith could reject any offer of work, was free to take up other work. Pimlico Plumbers did not reserve the right to supervise Mr. Smith's work, and Mr. Smith bore certain financial risks. In addition, Pimlico argued that Mr. Smith presented himself as self-employed for the purposes of income tax and VAT. However, the court considered the contrary provisions, including the fact that Mr. Smith's normal working hours consisted of a five-day week in which he should complete a minimum of 40 hours. The tribunal deeming there to be an umbrella contract in this case. In addition, the court held there was evidence of Pimlico's tight control over Mr. Smith, including that he should wear the branded uniform, drive the branded van to which Pimlico applied a tracker, carry Pimlico's ID badge at all times during any assignment, and closely follow the instructions of Pimlico's control room. There were also severe terms as to when and how much Pimlico was obliged to pay Mr. Smith, and a suite of restrictive covenants of his working activities following any termination. It must be added that this case, as is so often the case with most of the case law on this subject, is heavily fact specific. However, what it does highlight is the importance of contractual terms, but seen in the context of the actual working practices. If we then move on to the following slide, we then have the next case of Uber BV and others v. Aslan and others. Uber was founded in the US in 2009, and its smartphone app was released the following year. At the time of the original judgment on this case, there were 30,000 Uber drivers in and around the London area, with 40,000 nationwide. The original decision of the tribunal in 2016 had been eagerly awaited as a test case of the gig economy model of working. A number of Uber drivers brought claims of unlawful deduction of wages through alleged failure to pay national minimum wage and a failure to provide paid leave, both of which required worker status. Two of the drivers, including Mr. Aslam, were selected as test claimants. Again, as a preliminary issue, the Employment Tribunal had to consider, amongst other matters, if the drivers were workers or self-employed independent contractors, as they had been contracted with Uber, and what counted also as working time and working hours. The tribunal made a number of findings of fact, which included the fact that the drivers were not required to make any commitment to work. However, when a driver signs into the app, this usually signals they were on duty and able to accept bookings. The drivers also had to supply their own vehicles and were responsible for all running costs. Prospective passengers booked trips through the app. Once a passenger requests a trip, the app located an available driver who is logged in. The selected driver then had 10 seconds to accept, otherwise Uber located another driver. If a driver failed to accept a booking, warnings were then generated, which could have led to the driver's access to the app being suspended or blocked, thereby preventing the driver from carrying out any more work for Uber. The driver was not made aware of the destination of any passenger until collecting the passenger. But then the driver was expected to follow the directions the app provided unless the passenger stipulated a different route. At the end of the trip then, Uber calculated the fare and the driver could not agree or negotiate a higher fare. The passenger then paid Uber directly and Uber then paid the drivers weekly in respect of the fares earned, minus a service fee of between 20 and 25%. Also, what is of some significance here was the drivers were not required to wear a uniform. It was Uber's case that it was the driver's agent and it was the driver that entered into a binding agreement with the passenger to provide them with transportation services. The tribunal concluded that the drivers were in fact working for Uber under a worker contract. When they were in the territory, they were authorized to work, they had turned on the app, and they were ready and willing to accept fares. This was despite the what the tribunal termed as remarkable lengths Uber had gone to with regards its agreements with the drivers and its description of the legal relationship whereby the drivers were labeled as self-employed in business on their own and that Uber actually worked for the drivers, Uber's case being they are a technology platform providing business opportunities for drivers. The tribunal went on to hold that it was unreal to regard Uber as working for the drivers and that it was an essential feature of Uber's business to maintain a pool of drivers it can call on as and when a demand for driver services arises. The tribunal then concluded that the notion that Uber in London was a mosaic of 30,000 small businesses linked by a common platform was faintly, in their words, ridiculous. There was no contract, the tribunal found, between the driver and the passenger, as the Uber system did not allow for any real bargaining power between the driver and passenger. Once again, the tribunal found that the contractual documentation did not correspond to the reality of the situation, and therefore those contractual terms could be disregarded. Uber appealed to the Employment Appeal Tribunal, and the EAT dismissed the appeal. In the appeal, Uber argued that having found that the drivers were not obliged to switch on the app, it was perverse for the tribunal to conclude that Uber exercised control over the drivers. The EAT held that reading the full judgment of the tribunal, although there was no absolute requirement to accept a trip, this was nuanced by the tribunal's finding that a driver's access to the app could be lost if there was a failure to accept at least 80% of the trips. So once again, we have a situation here where a tribunal is prepared to look beyond the contractual documentation and look at the reality of the situation and conclude the contractual documentation does not accurately reflect the reality, and therefore a court is entitled to disregard it. If we also take the tribunal judgment as a whole, the tribunal identified various ways in which Uber's determination and desire to control its brand image led to a level of control which caused worker status to arise. And this was one of the reasons the tribunal was prepared to look beyond the contractual documentation. I should point out that Uber have appealed the Employment Appeal Tribunal dismissal of its appeal to the Court of Appeal. And I understand this is to be heard at the Court of Appeal at the end of this month. So this is still an ongoing case, and it's really is a case of watch this space. Moving on to the next slide, we come to the case of the Independent Workers Union of Great Britain against Roo Foods Limited, trading as Deliveroo. This was actually a case before the Central Arbitration Committee concerning the application of the IWGB, that it should be recognised as a union for collective bargaining purposes. Deliveroo was founded in 2013 in London and now operates in approximately 150 cities worldwide. Its business primarily involves the delivery of food and drink items from restaurants and others to customers' homes or other premises such as offices. In November 2016, the IWGB submitted its application for union recognition. Deliveroo, however, argued the application could not be accepted because the Deliveroo riders were not workers. The recruitment of Deliveroo riders was an important consideration for the CAC, and what that involved was a telephone interview, which acted as an initial sift. If the applicant passes the sift, they then must attend a trial session within which both they and their form of transport, which was usually a bicycle or motorbike, were assessed by Deliveroo trainers. If this is passed, the next phase is an online training course, which involved watching a number of videos containing instructions on how to carry out the role. There was then a multiple choice test, where the rider must score 100%, although they could take the test more than one time. There was emphasis throughout this training on presenting well as a frontline role, as well as aspects of food hygiene and health and safety. There were also CRB checks and DVS checks undertaken and paid for by Deliveroo before any rider was accepted. Once accepted, the rider then is required to sign a supplier agreement for which they have no scope for individual negotiations on the terms. They then pay £150 for an equipment pack containing a thermal box and bags to transport food and drink and various other items, including a branded high-vis jacket. However, if a rider stops working for Deliveroo, they can get a refund of the £150 if they return the equipment in good order. In the contract between Deliveroo and the riders, they did have a contractual right of substitution. Before the Central Arbitration Committee, it was agreed by both the union and Deliveroo that the riders provided work under a contract and it was not a contract of employment. In addition, Deliveroo did not argue it was the rider's professional client. Therefore, the dispute to workers' status centered around whether there was an obligation of personal service, and the key factor in the argument was the right of substitution. The Central Arbitration Committee was somewhat puzzled, however, as to why a rider would appoint a substitute given the total flexibility the rider had to accept or decline jobs without any detrimental consequences from Deliveroo. In addition, the rider would have to trust the substitute with his or her phone and login details. Also, the Central Arbitration Committee was a bit puzzled as to why would Deliveroo spend so much money on training the riders and pay for CRB checks, etc., if the riders had a free choice to substitute to potentially unsuitable individuals. However, the Central Arbitration Committee concluded the regulatory and reputational risks created by the absence of control and supervision by Deliveroo was a matter for Deliveroo. And there was, in fact, evidence of the substitution right being used in practice, with one particular rider witness in the hearing before the Central Arbitration Committee actually confirming they had on occasions subcontracted the work to another rider who was not engaged by Deliveroo for a 15 to 20% share of the delivery fee. The Central Arbitration Committee therefore found that there was an almost unfettered right of substitution in this case. That was a genuine right of substitution, and that this was fatal to the argument that the contract was one of personal service. The riders therefore were deemed as self-employed and not workers. So this case highlights how important the requirement of personal service is to employee and worker status. Where there is an almost unfettered right of substitution, it can therefore be fatal to any claim of employee or worker status that may be made by individuals, even where other factors may indicate such a relationship of employment or worker. In coming to this decision, the Central Arbitration Committee highlighted this case was very different to cases like Uber, since in that case, the question of personal service was not seriously in dispute. Rather, that case and others like it focused more heavily on the degree of control and subordination. Interestingly, 50 of the riders for Deliveroo also brought tribunal claims in the Employment Tribunal for national minimum wage and paid holiday. This claim has now been settled, which came hot on the heels of the IWGB being granted a right to seek judicial review of the Central Arbitration Committee's decision. Although we can only speculate as to why Deliveroo did settle these claims, and certainly they have not admitted any liability, solicitors for the riders believe the settlement indicated Deliveroo knew they were likely to lose at the Employment Tribunal. So perhaps those issues with regarding how much control they had over substitutes and how much money they spent on the training, etc., may well have persuaded Deliveroo, but unfortunately we have no confirmation of that. So then moving on to the next slide, what I have here is with the gig economy, casual workers and agency workers. And if we just concentrate on the gig economy for a second, the Oxford English Dictionary defines gig economy as a labour market characterised by the prevalence of short-term contracts or freelance work as opposed to permanent jobs. The Department of Business, Energy and Industrial Strategy, BIAS, created its own definition of gig economy as involving the exchange of labour for money between individuals or companies via digital platforms that actively facilitate matching between providers and customers on a short-term and payment-by-task basis. In the past, businesses with fluctuating demand would usually have a core workforce and then have casual workers filling in with periods of peak demand. Casual workers has included many different types of working arrangements within its definition, but typically it would include bank staff, seasonal workers, and individuals on 0 hours or short hours contracts. Casual workers have less rights than employees, but are entitled to certain rights such as national minimum wage, paid holidays, rest breaks, whistleblower protection, and the right not to be discriminated against. Many businesses within the gig economy have tended to engage individuals on a self-employed basis. However, as we have seen with the recent cases, some are now challenging their employment status as independent contractors and arguing with some success that they are in fact workers. The case law has shown us that there are risks associated with those businesses in the gig economy hiring staff as self-employed contractors. Certainly, if we look at the differences between an employee and a self-employed contractor, this is relatively straightforward with regards to distinguishing between them. However, the worker test that has evolved from the case law is heavily dependent on the facts of each case, which can make it difficult to know with any certainty whether an individual is truly self-employed. If self-employed contractors do challenge their status in court, this would entitle them to a number of employment rights if successful, which include, as I've mentioned before, national minimum wage, paid holiday, rest periods, and also a right to bring unlawful deduction of wages claims. Payments in this regard can be retrospective and therefore can amount to very high values of compensation. The recent settlement I mentioned with the Deliveroo case and the Deliveroo tribunal case was reported to be a six-figure sum. Zero-hour contracts are not a recent phenomenon, and these types of casual working arrangements have been around for many years. The advantage is the flexibility for the business and reduced cost compared to employing someone. However, as you are all no doubt aware, zero-hour contracts have been attracting bad publicity over recent years. And one particular area that came up for scrutiny was the use of exclusivity clauses where the employer did not want to guarantee work to the worker, but nevertheless did expect them to be available for work when it was offered and to only work for the employer during the engagement. As a result of government consultation, the Employment Rights Act 1996 was amended in January 2016, making exclusivity clauses in zero-hour contracts unenforceable. So they're no longer able to enforce those. I did also want to touch briefly on the agency worker regulations and the case of Brook Knight Guarding Limited v. Mattei. I should say that the agency worker regulations are notoriously complex and would probably cover a full webinar on its own. So I'm only going to touch briefly on this, but it is an important case for those that have zero-hour contracts that may actually assign workers to other companies. So Brook Knight had employed Mr. Mattei and other security guards on zero-hour contracts. And in Mr. Mattei's case, this was between 27th of December 2014 until 6th of October 2016. Mr. Mattei's contract included a flexibility clause enabling Brook Knight to assign him to different sites as required, although he was generally supplied to Mighty Security Limited, providing security services at the Citigroup site in London. As I say briefly, under the agency worker regulations, after a qualifying 12-week period, the agency worker is entitled to the same basic working and employment conditions as he or she would be entitled to had he or she been recruited directly by the hirer. An agency worker is defined under the regulations as an individual who is supplied by a temporary work agency to work temporarily and under the supervision and direction of the hirer, and has a contract with a temporary work agency, which is either a contract of employment or another contract to perform work or services personally. Mr. Mattei was claiming he was an agency worker and claiming that he was entitled to the same basic working conditions as the security officers employed directly by Mighty Security Limited, which he was not afforded at the time. The EAT upheld the Employment Tribunal decision that Mr. Mattei was indeed an agency worker. Brook Knight had argued that Mr. Mattei was not working temporarily for Mighty Security, but was actually a permanent worker for Mighty as the end user. The EAT disagreed, noting that the complete flexibility afforded to Brook Knight under the 0 hours contract, including the flexibility to move individuals from job to job, was fatal to this. If this power was never utilized, of course, it would diminish its relevance. However, there was evidence in this case that Mr. Mattei did act as cover and therefore was not assigned to Mighty on any indefinite or permanent basis. What this case shows us is even those staff members on indefinite zero-hour contracts can come under the agency worker regulations where they are assigned to an end user for more than the 12-week qualifying period. Although this case is undoubtedly fact-specific, for those businesses that operate similar to this model, this is now a relevant consideration. Moving on to the next slide, what I'm now just going to go through is some practical measures for you as businesses. And the first one is a written contract, which does reflect the reality of the situation. Certainly what emerges from the cases, and indeed from certain guidance, including that from HMRC regarding the application of IR 35, is that it is both the contracts in place and the reality of the situation which will be relevant regarding status. A contract that is drafted to reduce the risk of employment or worker status is important. Where that contract reflects the reality of the situation, a tribunal or court is unlikely to disregard the contractual provision and will first and foremost consider what has been expressly agreed between the parties. It is only where the practical reality of the situation is not or could not be in accordance with those contractual terms that a court or tribunal will then be prepared to look beyond the contractual documentation and possibly disregard them. So you'll see, therefore, that a written contract that does reflect the reality of the situation can be important. A genuine right of substitution I've got next, and we saw in the Deliveroo case how an unfettered right is fatal to an argument of worker status. It should be drafted as wide as possible, and there can be some control or veto by the business for those that are regarded as not suitable. However, this veto should not be excessively wide. If the right is exercised in practice, this can be conclusive evidence there is no requirement of personal service. I put there to watch for integration. And if the employee, as Simon has already mentioned, is part and parcel of your organization, they are more likely to be an employee or worker. Pimlico Plumbers gave us the example of wearing branded uniforms, driving branded vans, and using the Pimlico ID badge for all assignments. And again, under HMRC guidance, they give us the example of someone who is taken on to manage staff. This would normally be seen as an integral part of an organization, and therefore a strong indicator of employment status. Employment type benefits will also be a strong indicator of employment. This can be, for example, car parking space or canteen facilities. The next I've put is personal service companies, and these can indicate that the individual is in business on their own. It is the personal service company that then contracts with the business and the personal service company that is then responsible for the individual, including remuneration, taxes, liability, etc. However, once again, the contract will be important, and it would need to reflect the reality of the situation. The final bullet point on this slide, I've got allow outside interest and ability to provide services to others. Certainly, exclusivity of service will indicate a level of control akin to an employment relationship. In addition, it will indicate that the individual is not, in fact, in business on their own. There can be some control here. For example, if working for certain others would put the individual in direct conflict during any engagement. But again, any veto here should not be excessive. Moving on to the next slide, I've got some more practical measures. And the first is with regards to paid leave. And certainly paid holiday, sick pay or other types of paid leave is a strong indicator the individual is not self-employed. This is because the genuinely self-employed do not have these rights, and they are only rights for employees and for certain leave workers. For someone self-employed, they are in business on their own and therefore only get paid for the services they provide. Any business organization would not expect to be paid where it does not provide its services to a client. It's the same for those that are self-employed. In general, self-employed contractors are paid at a higher rate compared to, say, employees and workers, and that would be recruited. And so this allows for the fact that they don't get any paid leave. The next bullet point, I say that the individual should invoice fees. And this always helps to indicate that the individual is on business on their own. It also indicates the individual will only be paid for the services that actually provide, and the hours or days worked would be given on the breakdown in the invoice itself. I've then got the bullet point of no fees paid when services are not provided. And payment of a fixed fee each payment period, for example, a fixed fee each month, no matter what services are provided and or no matter how many hours or days that are worked, will indicate an employment relationship. I've already mentioned on a previous bullet point here about the risk with paid leave, and the risk is the same here, where the individual is paid irrespective of hours worked or services provided. In an employment relationship, there may be times when an employee has little or no work and the employer takes the risk on this. However, for those self-employed, it is the individual that takes the risk and financial hit when there is no work. I've then got the next bullet point. The individual should have overall control of provision of services. There will always be a certain level of control by a business as the engager, but it is the right of the control that matters. Where the individual is told and directed as to how to perform the services and duties, this will usually be seen as a strong indicator of an employment relationship. For example, an employee will usually be expected to work set hours each week with defined start and finish times. An independent contractor is more likely to have the freedom to work where and when they want. I've then got liability and corrections at own costs. Where the individual has to correct and rectify unsatisfactory work at their own in their own time for no additional reward, this does indicate an independent contractor relationship. And then moving to the final slide, I've got further practical measures here. The first is freedom to choose whether to accept or reject work. It is important that freedom is exercised without fear of any detriment. And we saw in the Uber case that targets of 80% of acceptance were required, or the driver's access to the app would be lost. And the Supreme Court determined this limited the freedom and evidenced control. I've then got the ability to set your own fee or price and the risk, again, using the example of Uber, the drivers were not permitted to negotiate a higher price than Uber had quoted. And this indicated they were not in the business on their own. I've then got freedom to use own equipment. A self-employed contractor would generally provide whatever equipment is needed to do the job. In contrast, where all equipment and material is provided, this can indicate employment. I do have to point out this isn't always the case. For example, where an encrypted laptop is required and provided for security reasons, this is unlikely to then be a material factor with regard to status. I've then got financial risk and insurance, and certainly individuals who risk their own money are less likely to be employed. This includes rectifying unsatisfactory work, which I've already mentioned, and bearing the risks of additional costs where a job overruns, for example. But it can also be where the individual is liable and indemnifies the client for any loss as a result of the services provided. And having insurance in place to cover such indemnities, therefore, does indicate an independent contractor relationship. I've then got reference by piece of work or project basis. This is an ideal rather than an absolute requirement, but certainly, although not a strong indicator, a long-term or indefinite contract can indicate an employment relationship. If it was therefore based on a particular project or a particular piece of work, for example, and the engagement was terminated in between such projects, or the individual was not paid between such projects, this would be a good indicator of an independent contractor relationship. And then finally, I've said consider employment where business the businesses requires the level of personal service and control. And certainly we've seen the risks involved where certain gig economy businesses have engaged self-employed contractors. But where the business requires a particular expert individual and also requires a degree of control over how that individual provides his or her services, there is considerable risk here if the individual is engaged as a self-employed contractor. And, you know, these risks can be costly for the business. Certainly, you know, it should be considered that they are taken on as employees. So if the reality of the situation is one where the individual is not really a self-employed contractor, I would give serious consideration to recruiting as an employee. And the business can then exercise the level of control it wants and require the individual to perform the services personally with the certainty and without fear of the potential additional costs and litigation further down the line. So just moving on to the last slide, it just remains for me to thank you very much for attending today's webinar. And if I could just remind you that Charlotte is answering any question, IM questions, and any questions that you do have will be answered post-webinar directly into your inboxes. Just for me to say many thanks again for attending this webinar. Thank you and goodbye.
Thank you, goodbye.